So again, the graphs, don't worry about it. But mainly, what you might notice, the light blue is a 10-meter depth, the dark blue is a 20-meter depth, and the sort of black color is a 30-meter depth. And what do you notice about these graphs? Do they all look the same? No, they're really different, right? Yeah, well, that's what I thought too. So when I went through and I measured growth at all these different places, what I found is that sometimes, like a 30-meter depth, there's hardly any growth at all. And other times, so say at 10-meter depth, there's a lot of growth. In fact, this growth period right here at 10-meter depth, you guys remember last year when we had that 40 days of rain in March? It just went and went and went. Well, I was able to get in the water, barely, and do some growth studies during that time. And as it turns out, that's actually the highest growth we had for Alameda at that particular time at 10 meters. And other stable isotope work that I've been doing, so looking at the nutrients that are in the algae and using some studies after we grind it up, I can tell where the nutrients came from. So whether they came from fertilizers or whether they came from open ocean. And what that work has told me is that plants that are really near shore, like at 10 meters depth or shallower, that are near streams and inputs, are influenced by fertilizers and growth like that. So near shore plants tend to have really fluctuating growth due to nutrients that we sometimes put into the system, whether through sewage or fertilizers or stuff like that. And in deeper water, the plants actually are influenced by open ocean growth, open ocean. So currents that bring nutrient-rich water from down deep up are the ones that influence the deeper growth. But basically, growth varies. So you come back to the same plant at a certain time, it could be growing a whole lot one month, and the next month hardly growing at all. So basically, it varies seasonally, and it varies between all the different depths, depending upon when you go and measure it. But what's cool is that if you average all this out and say, okay, I'm not worried about the variability, generally, how fast do these plants grow? What we find is they grow about 11.7 or about 12% over an 8-day period. That's not too bad. So in 8 days, they've replaced 12% of their body mass, so their number of segments. That's kind of pretty fast. If you do the math and convert that over, that comes to a little over 100 days, these plants are producing segments that are equivalent of their size. So they're actually growing really, really fast. Now, if they're growing really fast and sort of axes are getting shed off here and there, what do you think that means in terms of sand production? A lot, exactly. So you take all that into account, and this is how I do it. Don't worry about how I did it. But basically, I go through and I measure how much calcium carbonate is in each segment. Then I measure plants, thousands of them, all over Maui and Molokai and Lanai, over their entire depth range. And I find out that the average number of segments is 140. And then I figure out, okay, we did all these hundreds of surveys counting all these plants, and how many generally do you have per meter square? Well, on average, we have about 158. So if you multiply all that together, what you get is this amount of calcium carbonate in a particular area. Take our turnover rate, convert it to turnover per year, and at this point you have about 801 grams of calcium carbonate per meter square per year. One magic number to rule them all. That probably means absolutely nothing to you, which is okay. So what I did is took that number and tried to relate it to how it relates to other numbers that people have done in the rest of the world. So there's actually, believe it or not, people like me who spend their whole lives trying to get that magic number for different species of seaweed and Alameda, and in particular, Alameda like the one that we study here. The closest relative to it is a species called Alameda incrustata. So I went out and dug in all the literature. How much did they find? I looked at the location, the depth range that the data was taken from. So all this data that I used was extrapolated over 2 to 80 meter depths, so a pretty wide depth range. I found out how much calcium carbonate, so if I took a little segment, how much of it on average is actually calcium carbonate, and then got my magic number. If you compare, again, to all these other studies taken in all these different places, Bermuda, Antigua, New Caledonia, looked at the depth range that study was taken from, and the average amount of calcium carbonate, what we find is that our study basically has our sand that we make is an order of magnitude greater than what anyone else has ever found. So our Alameda meadows here in Hawaii Not only do they just kind of make sand, they make more sand than any other kind of palomino metal like this in the world. So that's really neat. So it's actually pretty heavily calcified, 73%. Here in Florida, it was a lot less calcified, that particular species. So I thought maybe we have a higher amount because our plants are more meatier in terms of calcium carbonate. But then these studies through here, these other locations were almost really close to ours, and yet they didn't have as much either.